Tonight's speaker is like Aurelius Augustinus, better known as St. Augustine, in his fascination with the issue of time. In about 400, Augustine asked these four temporal questions. Quid edim est tempus? Quis hoc facile breviterque explicaverit? Quis hoc adverbo verbum de illo proferendum vel cogitatione comprehenderit? Quid autem familiarius et notius in loquendo commemoramus quam tempus? So, what is time? Who will have easily and briefly explained it? Who will have understood it in thought to the point of offering a word about it? Yet in speaking, what do we recall more familiarly and more knowingly than time? It makes sense to introduce this paradox in Latin, since it was taking high school Latin classes that can be said to have started Brian Joseph on the path to becoming a historical linguist and eventually to taking the helm of the LSA. Yet it could also be speculated that there is a genetic component to this. Harriet Joseph was a Shakespearean scholar who published a book on a manuscript written in Latin by the bard's son-in-law, John Hall, and then translated into English, but with omissions that Professor Joseph filled in from her own familiarity with Latin. Edward Joseph was also an intellectually curious scholar who contributed to the psychoanalytic literature on the author Joseph Conrad, on twins, and on the consciousness of being conscious. And he was elected president of the American Psychoanalytic Association once and the International Psychoanalytic Association twice. Definitely a respected leader. There are presidents in this family. Moreover, Brian Joseph grew up in a family that on both sides traces its roots back to the Quebec of the early 1800s. If you are wondering whether they were successful, consider this. The patriarch of the Josephs in Canada, Henry Joseph, had a string of fur trading posts where John Jacob Astor worked for him. Still, none of this was really necessary for Brian to become a historical linguist known for his insight into the languages of Greece and neighboring areas, or for his insistence that diachrony includes the study of ongoing language change in the present. In my small overlap with Brian's years teaching at Ohio State and at linguistic institutes, I've been impressed with his sometimes explicit but mostly implicit advice to students that it makes sense to focus on one particular non-native language, along with your native tongue, rather than fixating on a theoretical issue and then trawling the languages of the world for ones that bear on that issue. He doesn't say it exactly this way, but the upshot is, go to a language and it will tell you its problems. In President Joseph's case, Greek has been good to him and he has been good to Greek. Not only did it lead him already as an undergraduate at Yale toward Hellenic and Indo-European linguistics, it also, through shared interests, introduced him to the person whose husband he became, and with a little stretching of the imagination, could be said to have led to Mary Clark and Brian's sons traveling with them in Greece and adjacent countries, and to one son's now living in Greece with a diplomat spouse, again that Canadian connection, with a child who knows an awful lot of Greek. That their other son is an economics professor has a Hellenic connection only via the etymology of economy as the management of a household or budget, I'll admit. In addition, not all students of Greek expand their horizons to the Balkans as a whole, but Brian did, and that fact has inspired other historical linguists as well as synchronic linguists who focus on language contact. President Joseph has called the Balkans a laboratory for linguistic change. And by that he means not just in an abstract sense, but also in terms of a place to carry out field work, whereby he has worked for some years specifically both on Greek in Albania and on Albanian. Mention of work in a concrete sense should remind us of Brian's years as editor of our Linguistic Society journal Language, during which time my own experience was that there were uniquely many articles with footnotes thanking the editor for useful comments on detailed specific issues, which attest to our president's breadth of interest and his competencies. In devoting his talk to us tonight to the issue of time, Brian Joseph returns to a topic which he and a colleague addressed at arguably greater length than in any other work on historical linguistics. For example, they devoted several pages to time travel, which ought to concern diachronicians at least as a logical possibility, but is virtually never discussed. At least two reviewers took the editors of the Handbook of Historical Linguistics, Volume 1, to task for discussing time travel in their introduction to the volume, despite the fact that time travel is often discussed by physicists, albeit under disguised names like CTCs for closed time-like curves. But Brian and his co-author got the last laugh. Both of the reviewers in question asked why the volume's introduction hadn't referred to certain publications, but those works had been published only after the handbook had gone to press, which made it seem like it was the reviewers who believed in time travel. In any field, time is a difficult topic, and linguists are a tough crowd. Does Brian Joseph face a kind of test by fire like that set for Prince Tamino in Mozart's opera Die Zauberflöte, the magic flute? Probably not. But the words of Schikaneder's libretto apply to Brian as well. When a character asks whether Tamino will succeed because he is not a warrior but a prince, the answer is, in German, noch mehr, ist Mensch. More than that, he is a human being. So please join me in welcoming to the podium someone who, as LSA president, is not only a prince among linguists, but also a mensch among linguists, Brian D. Joseph. Oops. Here we go.
Well, first of all, I want to say thank you to Rich. He's a tough act to follow. And I should have known that when I asked him to introduce me. What he didn't say is that the collaborator in question on the matter of time travel and so forth was Rich himself. But I'd like to thank all of you for being here. So let me say, Ευχαριστώ, Valimderit, Danyawada, Gratias Argo, Mutsumesk, Achu, Shukriya, blagodaryam, blagodaya, spasibo, merci, gracias, miigwech, toda rabaha, teshukuradirim, shukran, eskerik, asko, and to take just a sampling of the languages in which I know how to say thank you. It means a lot to me to see you all here with so many friends and familiar faces in the audience. As this address comes at the end of my year as president, it serves as my valedictory, a chance to reflect on the year, but also to say something substantive about linguistics. I plan to do a bit of both, though hopefully more of the latter than of the former. Different presidents have focused on and been involved in different activities and initiatives. I want to keep track of time, of course. Penny before me, for instance, pushed for the much-needed civility policy and all that that entails. In my case, I was fortunate because that initiative was implemented on my watch, so to speak, but it took no real effort on my part to get behind it as it was and is so important. But there's more. I'm very proud to have been president during the International Year of Indigenous Languages, even though, again, I can claim no, I mean zero credit for all that the LSA has done through various committees and through the work of dedicated individuals on this throughout the year. So too with initiatives from members and Charity Hudley, who I'm probably in the audience, I hope. There you are. And Christine Mallinson put together an initiative on race that was adopted during my year. And I also benefited from a robust linguistics in secondary schools initiative spearheaded by Rich Larson. Are you here? Yes. Somewhere, maybe. And I've done what I can to extend that locally in Columbus with help from two students of ours at Ohio State, undergraduate Victoria Paxton and graduate student Carly Dickerson, both of whom I hope are in the audience. I'm taking attendance. So I'm not sure what my legacy will be, if indeed there is any sort of legacy to the LSA presidency. But I did take the history of the field and of the LSA seriously in pushing for posts on, oops, I'm getting ahead of myself. I'm getting behind myself. There we go. There you go. There you go. Yeah, there we are. In pushing for these posts in the on the LSA website on Black History Month in February, on Women's History Month in March, on the LGBTQ Pride Month in October, and about LSA member, spy, and baseball player Mo Berg. And I also worked towards getting the Ling Story Corps initiative going, which I hope many of you will have taken part in, if not now, then at a future LSA meeting. Here I offer a shout out to Margaret Thomas, who should be around somewhere, and for her help with all of this, and volunteers, Clint Awai, Shuan Karim, and Seong Hwan Kim, who worked here at this meeting on this initiative, and also to Georgia Zelu and her team, who helped me pilot this at the Linguistic Institute at UC Davis last summer. And speaking of history, I have to say how humbled I am to be to see the roster of past presidents of the LSA with whom I share this stage in spirit. It's a virtual who's who of linguistics, giants in our field. It includes not only members of my dissertation committee, Calvert Watkins and David Perlmutter, but also scholars from whom I've learned much, and many among the thought leaders in linguistics today. Three of them were classmates of mine at Harvard, Sandy Chung, Ellen Case, and Alice Harris, who's out there somewhere, with whom I shared an office of what we really recognize as a cubicle more than anything during my time at Harvard. And some of these former presidents are among my heroes, my personal heroes in linguistics, Calvert Watkins, Eric Hamp, and Leonard Bloomfield. And mentioning Bloomfield, who spent time at The Ohio State University in the early 1920s, allows me to include a shout out to fellow Buckeyes who were presidents of the LSA also. Most recently, Arnold Zwicky in 1992, and before him, Ilse Lehista in 1980. And before her, we have to go all the way back to George Melville Bowling in 1932. I can add here that not only Bloomfield, then of the Ohio State German Department, but also several others at the Ohio State University, including Bowling, played a key role in 1924 in the founding of the LSA, and these are the names of those who were involved there. And among the past presidents of the LSA is my doppelganger, Larry Hyman. There are some of you who might think that they're seeing double. Wait a minute. Didn't Larry already give a presidential address 2 years ago in Salt Lake City? And wasn't the title something like the one today, but about tone and not about time? Actually, it was what tone teaches us about language. But no, Larry is not the Grover Cleveland of the LSA serving two non-consecutive terms as president. He and I really are two distinct people. As this unphotoshopped photo proves. And in case you're wondering, that's me on the... But I digress. So my talk today will be a blend of some history of the field, some language history, some quasi-philosophical musings, which is always dangerous territory, and some of my own personal history, as well as some of my research findings, all tying in with the general theme of time and language. I actually feel a bit upstaged by the here, because a conference that was announced last June at the University of Montreal on language and time mentioned some of this in its call for papers, some of the same themes that I had hoped to touch on here. But I swear I have been thinking about them for a long time. In fact, nearly all of my career, in a certain sense. So maybe it's better to think of this as great minds thinking alike. And in any case, it suggests that the topic is particularly timely. In some ways, therefore, this will be a kind of personal odyssey through details of my own professional development, but also touching on some research areas that have been especially important to that development, and a number of languages that have been a focal point for me, specifically Albanian, Avestan, Sanskrit, Old Irish, but most of all, as Rich mentioned, Greek. So let me start, with apologies to St. Augustine, with a mechanical kind of beginning for a talk with this title, What is Time? And let's see what the authorities say. Here's what the Oxford English Dictionary definition is: a finite extent or stretch of continued existence as the interval separating two successive events or actions, or the period during which an action, condition, or state continues. A colleague of mine at Ohio State, astrophysicist David Weinberg, gives a more concise but similar definition. Time is that in which things change. And we might even amend that to time is that in which shift happens. Thank you. I actually owe that bon mot to Hans Henrik Hoek, I must say. But I want to move away from such characterizations to different realms where time matters. So let me offer the observation that time is a phenomenon that humans have always had a sort of uneasy relationship with. This is amply reflected in art, and if we think of art as a means of the expression of the deepest of human concerns and yearnings, we can see why it's interesting to turn to artistic expression. As my title slide suggests, with its backdrop of Salvador Dali's The Persistence of Memory, we can see that time matters in the visual arts. And indeed, time is a phenomenon that has both plagued and intrigued great writers, artists, and musicians over the years, hence my reference to an uneasy relationship that we as humans have with time, something we've experienced since time immemorial. So I want to start by surveying some of the artistic testimony to the importance of time to humankind and to particular interpretations of time and of human interaction with time. Going beyond Dalí's 1931 painting, we can point to another one of his from 1957, The Disintegration of the Persistence of Memory, which continues the theme of melting clocks and concern about time. And in other visual arts, we can note this sculpture at JFK Airport in New York called History of Time. For reasons that I'm not really sure about, I don't know why, I imagine that it's because at airports we always have time on our hands. And I can mention a conference and an exhibition at my home institution in the past that took place about a year and a half ago, where the rationale for the conference is actually specifically mentioning language. So time is on artists' minds. Creative writing, too, and great literature offer some important perspectives on time. William Shakespeare, as Rich mentioned, my mother's area of expertise, said in The Tempest, "What's past is prologue." And William Faulkner in Requiem for a Nun said, "The past is never dead, it's not even past." And consider this from one of my favorite personal authors, Kurt Vonnegut. In Palm Sunday, he reproduces what he had said at the dedication of a new library at Connecticut College. "Like life itself, this speech will be over before you know it. Life is so short. I was born only yesterday morning, moments after daybreak, yet this afternoon I am 54 years old. I'm a mere baby, and yet here I am dedicating a library. Something has gone wrong." I have a painter friend named Sid Solomon. He was also born only yesterday. And the next thing he knew, it was time for him to have a retrospective exhibition of his paintings going back 35 years. Sid asked a woman claiming to be his wife what on earth had happened. And she said, "Sid, you're 58 years old now. You can imagine how he felt." For the record, I am currently 68 years old. So you can imagine how I feel. We also see reflections of this concern for time in music. The oldest complete musical composition that we have is the ancient Greek song that is on the epitaph of Sekilos from the 2nd century AD. And it is a lamentation about the passage of time. "While you live, shine, regret nothing at all, for life is short, time demands the end." And one of my mother's favorite song lyrics was Harry Belafonte's, "Time makes fool of man, they say, take me back to that distant day." And of course, the Rolling Stones famously said that time is on my side. Yes, it is. But it gets even better in terms of questions that we might be asking.
Oh, oh, what I want to know, where does the time go?
So the Grateful Dead and Uncle John's band gave us this question for which we can supply two answers. One comes from a fellow rock band.
Time keeps on slipping into the future.
So rock musicians may not be the most cogent of sources to answer a question like this, but consider this from a Nobel laureate. However, not in physics, but in literature.
Past as the present now will later be past.
So beyond Bob Dylan, here's what a real physicist has said about time. This is a famous quote from Albert Einstein that essentially summarizes the view of time that emerged out of his special theory of relativity from 1905. The distinction between the past, present, and future is only a stubbornly persistent illusion. And to return for a moment to artistic expression, here is a quote from T.S. Eliot from his four quartets about the past, present, and future, eerily reminiscent of Einstein. Time present and time past are both perhaps present in time future, and time future contained in time past. So based on this evidence, we can contrast an artist's view of time and a physicist's view of time and see that there actually is some convergence of thought, though not complete identity, some divergences as well. Well, turning now to language at last, sort of, you'll see. What would, or better, what could these various statements, especially Einstein's and Eliot's, mean from a linguistic perspective? This will allow us to get a sense of two other views of time, that of linguists and that of speakers. So to move in that direction, let's first delve into a discourse, a topic that linguists like to discourse about, and consider a favorite topic that humans discourse about, namely the weather. My wife, Mary Clark, also in the audience here, has made the following comment on the weather from time to time. The weather that you get in any given month is typically, in Ohio at least, a mix of borrowing from the previous month and looking ahead to the month to come. So April has some March-like days and some May-like days, and the same holds for each month and its neighbors, as these temperatures, the average high and low, show pretty clearly. And so also with languages. Finally, I get around to talking about language in a linguistics talk. At any given point in time, a synchrony, a language is a blend of material, sounds, constructions, vocabulary, and so forth, that's carried over from the past, mixed together with innovative alterations to the material in the system, including additions to it. Those innovations, in a sense, are or can be the future of the language, where it is heading. So each synchronic moment is a present state. Because of that, this means that the past, present, and future come together in a language at any identifiable synchronic stage. This is a la Einstein and Eliot. And what this means, present, past, and future come together, sorry about that. But what this means is that there is an ongoing tension in language between continuity, that is the past reflected in a synchronic present moment, and change, that is the seeds of future states. And this is a constant for any language, and indeed for virtually all human institutions. And this is where we can add into the mix ordinary people as speakers of a language and their sense of time, and also a linguist's sense. My feeling is that linguists are in a position to take what we can call a long view of time and diachrony. Tools such as the comparative method, as well as the philological interpretation of the evidence of inscriptions and texts of all sorts and such from the past, including the recent past, and the exploitation of corpora of spoken and written language, all give us long time. Using these tools, the linguist is able to see the distant past and even to peer into the unrecorded past, that is, a reconstructed past evident only from the evidence of its legacy in later linguistic data. The linguist is thus able to discern long-term developments that appear to be cycles, such as Jespersen's cycle involving negation, perhaps better called spirals, as von der Aura said, since there typically is what we call forward progress, but not a return to earlier states. Also, linguists can see what appear to be recurrent sorts of events of the type that we would therefore want to label as natural. Speakers, however, probably only care about short time and extended present. And in this regard, we can note Ferdinand de Saussure's observation from his Cours de Linguistique Générale that, quote, to the speech community, synchrony is the only true reality. But just what is synchrony for a speaker? Jen Hay and Paul Folks in 2016 in an article in Language talk about remembered time, the layers of learning from speakers' discussions of different times in their lives. If speakers store phonetically detailed memories, they say, over a long time period, they may access older variants when talking about older events. In other words, if there is a linguistic change in progress, the nature of that change should be replicated by speakers visible across their speech about distant versus recent events. Thus, speakers live in what is really an extended present, what philosophers sometimes refer to as a specious present. Now, admittedly, remembered time and extended present is a mild kind of diachrony. Based on a speaker's individual personal diachrony. It's a diachrony over what can be a relatively short time frame even. Let me illustrate this through a non-linguistic example. When driving, one often encounters on a road signs about traffic lights at an intersection saying something like the following, signal operation change. This is from an OSU campus intersection. Now, if you think about it, this sign is completely irrelevant information for someone coming to that traffic light for the first time. Such a person can only interpret it in synchronic terms, and the new sequence is all that matters. For someone who drives on that road often, or even at least once before, this is useful information, however, because their routine, their familiarity with the intersection, constitutes a synchronically relevant diachronic dimension that they carry with them as they confront their ongoing, continuing synchrony. I would like to suggest that the same is true with regard to language for speakers. As we go through familiar routines, these routines, because they are ingrained routines that are familiar and create expectations, they are part of our extended present, part of our knowledge of the past that we bring with us throughout our passage through time. This view of the relation between speakers and time on the one hand and linguists and time on the other has several consequences for us as linguists, and especially as historical linguists, with regard to how we interpret data and the methodology that we employ. Let me enumerate and expound upon these consequences. First, we often interpret differences that we encounter from our expected routine as being evidence of change, which may or may not actually be true. Difference does not necessarily equate to a change being someone actually doing something differently, changing what had been our own usage. But still, this interpretation is perfectly understandable from a speaker's point of view. Fred Householder discussed this in his 1981 presidential address published in Language in 1983, and referred to it as kyrioleksia, which literally means literalness in Greek, but which Householder used to mean essentially an individual speaker's sense of a norm, literally, against which to judge other variants. Related to this is what Arnold Zwicky has called the recency illusion in a 2005 post in Language Log, and is discussed by Rich in a chapter of the Handbook of Historical Linguistics due out later this year. As Zwicky puts it, it's the, quote, belief that things you have noticed only recently are in fact recent. Rich cautions against this, against using this as a methodology for identifying change. Second, there can be change in a short time. For instance, we can point to the rise of trendy lexis, the use of words or phrases that dominate discourse and media for a brief time and then fade from use or become just ordinary items. For instance, twerk for a sexually suggestive type of dance, first attested in this sense in 1993, but which enjoyed a brief renaissance in 2013, would be one example. Or the spread of phrases used as metaphors like low-hanging fruit, which I heard from administrators in the 90s for the first time, or blends like red line in the sand, across, as I understand it, of line in the sand and red line, or even syntams like because plus NP that was the subject of considerable attention at the LSA and especially the American Dialect Society in 2013 as a word of the year. We can wonder about the lasting power of such trends, but they bespeak changes nonetheless. Third, relatedly, we can, that's a side note which we can ignore for the moment. Third, we can witness real change with lasting generalization over speech community within our lifetime. For instance, there's a suburb just west of Columbus known as Hilliard. That town was originally called Hilliards, short for Hilliards Station, since it was founded along a railroad route. Sometime after the 1950s, it came to have its present designation of simply Hilliard. There was a shift in the railroad lines that was partly or largely responsible, perhaps, even though some older residents still keep the S. So there has been a subtle but real change in that suburb's name, and so too in the use of Central Ohioans in referring to that place. As a methodological side note, let me point out that the distinction between older residents with Hilliards and younger residents with just Hilliard and speakers in Central Ohio with just Hilliard shows the value and importance of the apparent time construct as a way of making inferences and hypotheses about language change. This construct is related to the uniformitarian principle that Lebov has used so effectively, namely that the processes of change evident today were available and applicable in earlier times. So this is another tool that we can use for a glimpse into the past, but one that is based in individuals' personal diachrony spread out across the speech community. And we can no doubt witness this repeatedly in our daily lives as we evaluate what we hear from others. I mentioned one such case from my own life in recent years because I know that the other person involved is in the audience. At a gathering at my house of sociolinguistics and historical linguistics students a few years ago, I mentioned something about when I was courting my wife, and one of the students there, Katie Carmichael, who is in the audience, I believe, said in a totally non-derogatory way and just as a sociolinguistically informed reaction, "Oh, court, how cute, how quaint, how old-fashioned." So fourth, we can experience differences that stand out as synchronic anomalies, and we can learn from them about history. An illustrative example has to do with one of the so-called traditional fight songs associated with Ohio State football and sung at football games even today. The song was written around 1906, and it starts like this. I want to go back to Ohio State, to old Columbus town, da-da-da-da-da, and so forth. The last line of the song is... will win the game or know the reason why. And it's always puzzled me and intrigued me. I've wondered what it really means. And in particular, why would we not know the reason for a loss at the end of a game? It's a lost fumble. It's a missed field goal. It's something like that, a targeting call, a roughing the kicker penalty, and so forth. So how would we not know if we take, and especially this is taking the word know in its now usual sense of having knowledge of or understanding something. And especially the disjunct of winning or knowing has always seemed a bit odd to me. So to me, a more sensible meaning for know would be find out or learn. That is, we'll win the game or we'll learn the reason why. Of course, as a historical linguist, I wondered if the meaning of know had shifted at some point. And here the Oxford English Dictionary actually provides an answer. Oops, yes, okay, sorry about that. Here's the answer from the OED. There is a meaning, as you see there, basically learn, ascertain, or find out, which is marked as being now obsolete. And it has been supplanted by the more familiar meanings of know that we think of now. Clearly then, the line was written when this meaning of find out was not obsolete. And in this anomalous meaning of the fixed phrase, know the reason why, compared with the current meaning of its individual parts, we see evidence for change in our language in the change of meaning of this very common verb. The restriction, by the way, of an older meaning to a limited context, embedded in what for all practical purposes is part of a ritual utterance. This is Buckeye football, after all, and for anyone who doesn't know, OSU football is like a religion for many Buckeye fans, and the Ohio State football fight song is like a religious hymn. And this is something that's seen in many, many cultures and is especially well instantiated in the ancient Indo-European languages and the often ceremonial texts and ritual texts that illustrate them. The work of Calvert Watkins on ritualistic language involving grains in ancient Indo-European languages is a case in point, as he observes that the Homeric phrase alfi kai hudor, barley and water, with its archaic noun form alfi, occurs in what Watkins refers to as a solemn utterance, and it has a ritual use with ritual parallels in Hittite and Vedic Sanskrit. Fifth, although these isolated examples of language change are admittedly not particularly earth-shattering, they do have significance collectively. In particular, after years of studying the phenomenon of language change, my considered opinion, for what it's worth, is that language change on a large scale is really nothing more than the accumulation of changes on a small scale. For instance, the syntax of because, the form of the town name Hilliard, the meaning of no, and so forth. And one never knows which small adjustment will catch on and spread to become something larger in scope. And by large scale here, I mean the sorts of changes that have led to English and German becoming different languages, though they share a common Germanic source, or French and Spanish being so different, even though both spring from Latin. But these large differences, the result of changes that affected each language individually as it split off from a common starting point, started with small alterations, with small differences between speakers in matters of detail. Small changes are precisely what we see distinguishing older and younger speakers regarding Hilliards versus Hilliard, or distinguishing different chronological stages of English in the case of no. Sixth, the short time view means that some constructs that linguists take for granted may not mean much to speakers. So it is, in my view, with cycles, as I alluded to earlier. Typically, speakers are not in a position to view all of the relevant stages, and they know only the synchrony of their experience, as de Saussure reminded us, thus synchrony and their extended present. Now, admittedly, there can be evidence from apparent time pointing to stages, but directionality cannot always be successfully determined from apparent time. So to shift gears a bit, let me return to Einstein. He taught us, Einstein taught us time is relative, and in a sense, we see the relativity of time in the difference of the view of the linguist versus that of the speaker, as it is a kind of relativizing of the time dimension, relativized to the different perspectives and different sets of tools that are available to linguists and to ordinary speakers, respectively. And as an interlude, let me emphasize relativity by turning to another kind of artistic expression, namely the joke. A man asks God, "What is a million years like to you?" And God answers, "It's like a second." Then the man asks, "What is $1 million like to you?" And God answers, "It's like a penny, my son." And the man then asks, "So God, can I borrow a penny?" God says, "I'll get back to you in a second." The ancient Sanskrit text known as the Manavadharma Shastra, the Laws of Manu, gives a definition of a year for Brahma, the creator. By one reckoning, I won't go through the Sanskrit, but by one reckoning, a human year is one divine day, a divine year is 360 or so human years, divine age is 12,000 years. If you add that up, multiply it up, you get to over 4 million human years for the daytime period, and the night is said to be also equal, thus a total of approximately 8.5 million years for one Brahmanic day. Oops, sorry, there we go. So time and its measure must be treated as relative, quite possibly culturally embedded and culturally relativized. Seventh, another consequence of taking time seriously concerns stability. In particular, Taking the long view of time means that the much-discussed issue of stability in language either vanishes or at least becomes a temporally very local affair. My view of stability is that almost everything changes if we just wait long enough. Again, we can consider what people say about the weather in Ohio. If you don't like it, just wait. It will change. And note that really all we know about demonstrable language change and putative stability is what we see in a narrow temporal window of approximately 10,000 years out of the much longer time span, maybe 5 to 10 times longer, or even much more than that, the total span of human language going back to the origin of language deep in prehistory. In a sense, then, all of our concern for language over time is really about what elements in a given synchronic state are continuations of material from an earlier state, and what elements are innovations, thus showing change. Yeah, there we go, sorry. So what we really have then is continuity in the face of change and change in the face of continuity. This is what the time dimension in language, and really all of life for that matter, really means. I'm going to turn now to an extended case study showing continuity and change, focusing on the verb in Greek and one particular marker associated with tense in the verb. Some of this gets a bit technical, but this is linguistics after all, but I'll try to make it intelligible. First, this is how a recent study of the Greek verb by Klaus Bentheim has described temporality. Greek verbs can convey temporal deixis through the use of tense, as is the case in many of the world's languages, with the imperfect and aorist conveying events anterior to the time of speaking, the present conveying events simultaneous to the time of speaking, and the future conveying events posterior to the time of speaking. He notes, though, that this is not 100% accurate because there is the use of the future with imperatival meaning and also the nomic aorist, which is the use of the past tense aorist in timeless statements. Now, this is more or less the standard view. There are lots of questions that can be asked about this and lots of recent scholarship, but this is where I'm coming from today. Associated with the imperfect and aorist past tenses was a marker of past time known in the literature as the augment. This prefix continues a form that can be reconstructed for Proto-Indo-European, perhaps originally a free word, maybe a deictic element, perhaps better, following Watkins, 1964, a sentence connective. But for directly reconstructable Proto-Indo-European, it was a prefix. Oops. Yeah, there we go. It was a prefix on the verbal stem. And it is attested as such in Indo-Iranian, in Greek, and Armenian. But importantly, there are traces in other languages, for instance, in Albanian, as Hamp has argued, and there are positive indicators in Anatolian, in Hittite and Luwian especially, and in Celtic, in Old Irish, that point to a prefixal augment as part of Proto-Indo-European in the broad sense and not a dialectal feature within the proto-language speech community as reconstructed from the evidence of the attested stages, branches. An example is there at the bottom with segmentation added and the augment in red, Greek epere, Sanskrit abharat, and Armenian eber. From Proto-Indo-European eberet, he or she was carrying. Now there was also in Indo-European and a form which in Proto-Indo-European that looked like a past tense but was without the augment. This is known as the injunctive. It was a tenseless form, perhaps better viewed as unspecified for tense, mood also for that matter, that had a few specific functions, but was dramatically used in Vedic Sanskrit for timeless statements of general truth, and some other functions as well. Now, Greek presumably inherited the Proto-Indo-European distinction seen in Vedic Sanskrit between tensed indicative augmented forms and untensed timeless forms without the augment. The use of augmented forms in timeless statements in Greek, the nomic aorist that I've referred to, might seem anomalous at first, certainly unexpected if the augment is associated specifically with past time, but it makes sense in the context of an original distinction between unaugmented forms that are timeless and augmented forms that are tensed. Thus, the timeless injunctive is the likely source of the gnomic aorist. Once the unaugmented, well, let me go back a sec. Well, okay. Once the unaugmented forms receded, their functions could have been taken over in part by their closest neighbors, namely the similar forms that differed only in having the augment. Now, what about the formal side of the augment, that last item there on the screen? How is the augment realized in Greek? It's mostly an obligatory marker of indicative past tense, part of the morphological makeup of past tense forms, either the imperfect or the aorist. This is known in the literature as the syllabic augment. It's also realized by the lengthening of an initial vowel, the so-called temporal augment. For instance, the verb etelo, I wish, with the past tense etelon, with lengthening. It's found in the earliest attested Greek, namely Mycenaean Greek of roughly the 14th century BC, as in the form apedoke, he gave back, where that first e is the augment, and maybe a couple other forms as well. But mostly in Mycenaean Greek, we have past tense forms to the extent that they occur at all with no augment, which is also the case largely in Avestan, by the way. So we have apudoke, which is the unaugmented form corresponding to apedoke. There's vide and teke without augments. Now this is consistent with the idea that the absence of the augment is a matter of the loss of the independent function for the augmentless injunctive. This situation is also seen in later, but still early Greek, namely in poetic use in Homeric epic of the 8th century BC, and also in early poetic use by Hesiod and Pindar. Now it is generally held that these unaugmented apparent past tense forms continue in a functionally transformed way, the Proto-Indo-European augmentless injunctive, even though it has long been suspected that the different metrical shape of augmented versus unaugmented, they differ in syllable count, for instance, may have played a role in their use in poetry. But there are other indications of for other functions associated with the augment that are more pragmatic in nature. Discourse type, for instance, as Jimmy Wolfe has argued, and evidentiality, as Philippe de Decker has argued. So in early Greek, the upshot is that the augment appears to be optional, though possibly controlled in part by meter and in part by nuanced semantic and pragmatic concerns. Still, by classical Greek of the mid-5th century BC, from a purely formal standpoint, the augment is generally obligatory in past tense forms. But there are some exceptions beside the gnomic aorist, which, recall, has the form of a past tense but not the function. And there are also some oddities about the augmentation of verb forms. For instance, there are some legitimate past tense forms that are lacking the augment that occur in normal, that is, prose Greek, like eucheto for he or she wished versus the augmented form eucheto from the verb elchomai, to wish, so also with the verb to find. And second, there are some forms that have multiple augments. This was pointed out to me by Chiara Zanchi, who is in the audience, and I thank her for this. For instance, enekomein, I endured from aneko. For what it's worth, Schwitzer, in talking about these forms, attributed them to an uncertainty, an Unsicherheit, as to language sensibility. Third, we see in Greek the analogical spread of the temporal augment, that's the lengthening, the augment by lengthening of an initial vowel, from vowel initial verbs to consonant initial verbs where they don't belong etymologically. For instance, boulomai, I want, has a past tense e boulomain, I wanted, in place of the expected e boulomain. Probably this was affected analogically by the roughly synonymous verb etelon, I wanted. Fourth, there are misplaced augments. Some are a kind of double augment also. In the usual case, The augment is immediately to the left of the verbal root, and any other adverb-like prefixes, so-called preverbs, appear to the left of the augment. Moreover, in the usual case, the accent in past tense forms is retracted to the left, but does not go farther left than the augment. The verb for sit down, kathidzo, offers an interesting set of past tense forms. We find the etymologically correct kathidzon, where the long I shows augmentation by lengthening. This is the temporal augment. There's no accent retraction farther left than that augmented vowel. There's a variant form, the result of a reanalysis, kathidzon, which has the accentuation as if kath, which is originally a preverb, is part of the root. And there's no overt augment in this, marking only by lengthening, that is, assuming that that E is long, which there's no direct evidence for. The further variant at the bottom there is shows the effects of a second reanalysis, ekathidzon, in that the form is regularized via the overt syllabic augment e, with the presumed lengthening of the temporal augment E overlooked. And that E is positioned as if kath were part of the root, not a preverb. Another anomaly is finding the verbal augment on an original noun. In the verb ekrain versus crane, it was necessary. Crane is from a univerbation, a contraction of the noun kre, necessity, and ain, the augmented past tense form of the verb to be. So of these two forms, crane is the older form, with the augment built into the A of the ain at the end. Ekrain shows the effects of taking the univerbation seriously, with moreover kre, a noun taken that is reanalyzed as a verb, so that the augment is needed in the past tense, and the e is accordingly is added, giving it two augments and one attaching to an ostensible noun. Overall, though, in ancient Greek, with regard to the augment, we can say it's fairly regular as to its realization, but there are some of these rough edges that I've been pointing out. So let us now fast forward to modern Greek. What do we find for the augment 2,500 years later? The augment is still hanging on productively. And everywhere that it occurs, it is still a prefix and still mostly e. In standard modern Greek, it is phonologically determined, occurring only when it's stressed. So we have, for instance, ephera, I was carrying, but pherame, we were carrying, continuing ancient Greek, eperon, eperomen. Now there's greater realization of the augment in regional dialects, where it occurs even when unstressed, as in ancient Greek. For instance, in the Greek of southern Albania, where I've been doing fieldwork in Greek-speaking enclaves over the past decade, we find eskeftike, he thought, versus standard modern Greek skeftike, and other forms like that, with similar kinds of unstressed augments in Cypriot Greek and other dialects. But there's still some funny stuff, some oddities as well with the augment, as in ancient Greek, but even more so. We see, for one thing, the spread of the original temporal augment, which is now pronounced E, in the Greek of southern Albania, where we have epheron, they carried, versus standard modern Greek, epheron. There's also evidence of reanalysis with preverbs leading to misplaced augments from an etymological point of view. For instance, the modern Greek form eprokito, it was a matter of, which is admittedly a kathareveza, that is high style form, but is modern and is used nonetheless, colloquially, derives from a preverb pro plus a root ki and a personal ending to. But the preverbal prefix plus root is treated as a new root, and thus with the augment outside of, that is to the left of the etymological preverb. This is unlike ancient Greek, where the augment was inside of, that is to the right of the preverb. So modern Greek eprokito is from eprokito, augment, preverb, root, plus ending, whereas ancient Greek prukito is from proekito, ekato, preverb, augment, root, plus ending. There are also some non-augment vowels, that is, semantically and morphologically empty vowels that were originally augments but have come to be embedded in verb forms as if they're just part of the root. For instance, katevazo, to put down, The usual form of the preverb is kata, and the usual form of the root is vaso, and that e can comes in from a past tense form like kata vaza, I was putting down, generalized into the present as part of the stem. So also with anaveno and other and a few other verbs as well. And in regional dialects, we find multiple augments. So in the Greek of southern Albania, we find epiga from earlier Greek, hupega, where that a contains the augment, the temporal augment, the lengthened one, positioned to the right of the preverb hup, so that the earlier form consists of preverb, augment, root, plus ending, whereas the modern dialect form, epiga, is from augment, preverb, augment again, plus root, plus ending. And in Cypriot, it really gets hairy. There are compound verbs, those with contentful prefixal elements, which show some remarkable augmentation. This is based on work of Natalia Pavlou from the University of Chicago. So a compound verb like misopsino, I half cook, from miso, half, and psino, cook. We find a past tense that has the augment to the left of the compound element, e misopsisa, I half cooked. But interestingly, we also find two augments, one on each part, e miso epsisa, and with two prefix-like elements, like xana, again, and para, over, we have three augments, e xana epara epsisa, I overcooked it again. They overdid it, we might say, again. We can compare the modern Greek situation to other modern Indo-European languages. In Armenian, the augment occurs only on what would otherwise be monosyllabic past tense forms, thus only with the third person singular, eber, he carried, versus beri, berer, I, you carry. In Iranian, for instance, in Yagnobi, the augment is an obligatory part of the morphological structure of the verb, as in Proto-Indo-European and ancient Greek, but the form is different, with an a rather than an e, reflecting an Indo-Iranian sound change of e to a. So in Greek, we see the most enduring augmentation in terms of form and function, thus with considerable continuity, all in this one little sound. The e of ephera is pretty much as it was 6,500 years ago in Proto-Indo-European. But this continuity comes with considerable change as well to the modern Greek standard modern Greek situation of phonologically determined use of the augment to the triple augment in Cypriot. And these oddities continue, though not in a direct lineal descent. And these oddities, by the way, can be found throughout medieval Greek as well. So we have continuity and change all wrapped up in a single monophonematic, monosyllabic prefix. I give this example of the augment as a powerful case study illustrating the tension between continuity and change, between stability and instability. So is there continuity with the augment? Yes, yes, its form and function are more or less the same now as in the deep past. Is there stability with the augment? Yes, again, especially in dialects where it's obligatory. Is there change with the augment? Yes, yes, indeed, there is. And is there instability with the augment? Again, yes, because it's been subject to all kinds of reanalyses and changes. And yet, despite its seeming fragility as a single vowel on the left edge of a word, something that has been lost in most branches of the Indo-European family, the augment persists in Greek and is still a key part of Greek verbal morphology. So there's a moral here, I would say, namely that it can be difficult to predict what's going to happen with elements in a given language at a given time, and moreover, that the circumstances in a given language may not be fully replicable in all languages. Thus, we can certainly look for generalizable trends and principles guiding language change, but we should not be surprised when each language we examine shows its own peculiarities of development. Let me begin to move in the direction of wrapping up, because I'm way over time, but so be it. I've been talking about the relevance of time, so I sort of feel I should say something about the diachrony of the field, but that would be a whole other talk, as they say, so I'll not indulge myself, except insofar as talking about a personal diachrony, which I can say something about. In fact, I would be remiss if I left this podium without mentioning the remarkable teachers, mentors, and scholars that I've had interactions with over the years. And this, in turn, does give a glimpse into the history of the field as it has affected me and my development. Doing historical linguistics, especially Indo-European linguistics, it's almost impossible not to get the sense of standing on the shoulders of giants. For me, it's not just the amazing scholars of the 19th and 20th centuries whose works I read and have drawn on, but also the ones who most immediately and intimately affected me directly. So I want not only to thank my teachers, but also to note, without wanting to sound like I'm bragging, that the more I've learned over the 40-plus years since my graduate studies at Harvard, the more I've come to appreciate the remarkable scholarly tradition that I've been fortunate enough to be plugged into. There are two key strands to my educational genealogy. Regarding historical linguistics and Indo-European linguistics more generally, there's a lineal descent from Ferdinand de Saussure to Antoine Meillet to Émile Benveniste to Calvert Watkins via Cal's attendance in Paris in the 1950s of Benveniste's lectures, to Jay Jasanoff, who will figure again in a moment, to me, and then on to others. Regarding there are also these lateral influences, we can call them, such as Jay Jasanoff, though he's also part of the direct lineage, Joachim Schindler, more on him in a moment, and also Eric Hamp. Regarding Sanskrit, there's lineal descent from William Dwight Whitney to Charles Landman to Walter Eugene Clark to Daniel Ingalls to me and on to others, crossed with Wilhelm Brandenstein to Manfred Meyerhofer to Joachim Schindler to me. And also, to the extent that I am theoretically oriented and have made contributions in that sphere, I have to acknowledge the input of my professors in that realm, Judith Aysen, George Hankamer, Susumu Kuno, David Perlmutter, and Hadge Ross. Moreover, all of these professors in historical linguistics and in linguistic theory were also fantastic teachers. Calvert Watkins' lectures, for instance, were masterpieces, and no one could teach syntactic argumentation better than David Perlmutter, unless it was Judith Aysen or George Hankamer, who learned their style of teaching from David himself. And in a small way, I feel that the contribution that these remarkable linguists made to my development as a teacher has been a part of my, and therefore their, legacy, as three of my advisees have won teaching awards at their respective institutions. Hope Dawson, who's in the audience, I trust, at Ohio State, Selena Sampson Anderson at Valparaiso University, and Panayotis Pappas at Simon Fraser University. Right on, yes, yes. And I've learned from all those whom I have worked with on papers and books, but especially those that I've collaborated with the most in alphabetical order, Christopher Brown, Hope Dawson, Victor Friedman, Hans-Henrik Hock, Rich Janda, Paul Postel, and Rex Wallace. And I must also mention two colleagues, OSU colleague Arnold Zwicky, for many reasons, but also due to his work on clitics that had a profound impact on my own investigations of the modern Greek verbal complex, and University of Chicago colleague Michael Silverstein, due to his deep knowledge of the history of our field and all that I've learned from my interactions with him. And as for my students, who I've learned from, who are they? All of them, every single one. I've also learned from the hundreds of language consultants over the years in Greece, Albania, and Lithuania, and in this year for offering me their insights. But in this tail end of the year of Indigenous languages, let me acknowledge also my Cree consultants from Alberta in my postdoctoral year at the University of Alberta in 1978 to 79. And I can mention, I should, of course, as long as I'm talking about enablers, let me give a shout out to my family, my wife and kids, Mary Clark, David Clark Joseph, and Adam Clark Joseph, my siblings, Alan and now deceased Leela, my parents, as Rich mentioned, professors, both of them, Harriet Joseph and Edward D. Joseph, and my dad, president of his professional organizations. And I'd like to end with a further detail or two about my life and about what that detail means. I'm the first to admit that I've enjoyed a life of privilege, growing up as an upper-middle-class white male. Admittedly, as a Jewish white male, which I mentioned because it might lower my privilege score a little, but the real privilege that I would claim is how much of a privilege, with this word understood in a different sense, it has been to be able to spend my life studying something as interesting as the way languages, and especially the Indo-European languages, and especially the Greek language, have changed over time. This type of privilege is one that all of us in this room can take part in, and all of us can share in as much as we all spend our time studying what we love and adding to the great store of human knowledge through our experimentation, our reading of texts, our examination of corpora, our interviewing of speakers, and so on. That is, by engaging in the humanistic and scientific enterprise of linguistic research. So I say this proudly, and I wear this particular privilege proudly, as we all should, and I proclaim for all, both within the academy and outside of the academy, to hear that what we do as humanistic scientists, applying scientific methodology to the examination of a uniquely humanistic phenomenon, namely human language in all its dimensions, it is important and it is worthy of the support of the academy and of society at large. It's my firm belief that our research, and indeed all humanistic research, may not extend life as, say, medical research does, but it enhances life. And it's fair to ask whether life without enhancement, without enjoyment, would be worth extending. So I close with this plea, admittedly preaching to the choir, offering a justification for what we as humanists in a broad sense do. When Antonio Cassese, the Italian prosecutor in the Yugoslav War Crimes Tribunal in The Hague, arising out of the Balkan Wars of the 1990s, when he would take a break from the angst and horror of the courtroom, with the testimony about mass killings and torture and other unspeakable acts that nevertheless were being spoken about and did happen, he would restore his soul by going across town to the Moritz House Museum in order to, in his words, spend a little time with the Vermeers. That is, to look at some paintings by Johannes Vermeer, one of the greatest of the great masters of the Dutch Renaissance. Seeing the sublime beauty of the Vermeers, this is a well-known one that's there in the Moritz House, with their delicate lines and their peacefulness and serenity, to use the characterization that Lawrence Wexler gave in his account of Cassese in the tribunal, essentially reminded Cassese of the good that humans can do. So in a curious way, the arts and humanities can offer relief from humanity. And this is what I mean by saying they enhance our existence. They may not extend life, but they enhance life. And what would life be like without the humanities, without humanistic enterprises like the field of linguistics? I shudder to think. Indeed, research into the history of languages offers a window into what unites us as humans. And let me give an example of what I mean. We read in the Rig Veda, as Wendy O'Flaherty of the University of Chicago puts it in her introduction to her translations of Vedic hymns, we read all about, quote, conflict within the nuclear family, uneasiness about the mystery of birth from male and female parents, the preciousness of animals, the wish for knowledge, inspiration, long life, and immortality. In many ways, these seem to be universal human concerns, and such a characterization of content could be applied to what anyone of us see today in the tabloid press, on the internet, in titles of bestseller lists, and so forth. Using observations such as these, which can be multiplied across all of the ancient languages we deal with, I'd like to suggest that along with the, that's what Wendy says. And there's more, but here we go. I had to cut this down from about an hour and a half, so anyway. I'd like to suggest that along with the linguistic uniformitarianism that I mentioned earlier, that Lebov has exploited so dramatically to use the present to learn about the past, modeled to some extent on the geological uniformitarianism of Charles Lyell in the 19th century, we can recognize a humanistic uniformitarianism that the study of ancient texts gives us, emphasizing the view that we get of just how much we as humans today are like humans in the past. Thus, language and linguistics, and to a large extent historical linguistics, offers ways of understanding our humanity. I close with this great quote from Jim McCauley, one of my predecessors at this podium, from 1996. Languages are weird and wonderful things. As long as you're perceptive enough, there's plenty to keep you happy and busy. So let's stay busy and let's stay happy. Thank you. I apologize for the overtime, but I appreciate you staying as long as you did.
Is the speaker willing to entertain questions?
I will entertain questions as long as you entertain me, please.
That's what I was going to say. Is the audience willing to entertain the speaker?
We're not.
There's a microphone?
As the case may be.
And we should hurry to answer the questions, ask the questions, because
the reception awaits us.
As various authors have pointed out, people say time goes, but one poet said, no, time stays, we go.
We go. Arthur, yes, do you have a question?
Yeah.
Please.
Well, I have to warn you that this question stems from idle curiosity.
Okay, fair enough.
Not from any mega meta-theoretical issue. Do augments continue to occur in modern Greek
yes.
on nouns
no,
and perhaps
no.
adjectives?
No. They're only on verbs in modern Greek or things that have been reanalyzed as verbs.
It's a thing from back then.
That was just one lone example of an oddity that where there was a noun that was reanalyzed as a verb. But from an etymological standpoint, it looks quite unusual.
Okay. Not what I wanted to hear.
Okay, good.
That's okay.
Always glad to be of service. All right. I think at this point I'm supposed to call Marianne up to the stage.
Do you hand her a gavel?
I do. And with this, at this point, I symbolically turn over power to her, the power of the gavel. Use it wisely.
Thank you.
And now to the after-dinner entertainment out in the lobby. Thank you.